Good morning, church. Before we begin, let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this day. We pray that you speak to our hearts this morning as we look for that perfect day. Open our eyes to see you. Open our ears to hear your voice. Open our hearts to receive you. Speak to us, Lord. Your servants are listening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, church, last week Pastor Lynette started us on the second letter to the Thessalonians. And the encouragement is that God works through us. He works through us through other people. He works through us through the church that we're in. He also works through us through the challenges of our life as we work for Him. And as we do so, we are changed from glory to become more like Jesus Christ. The Christian life is not static. The Christian life is exciting. The Christian life is supposed to be progressing as we reach the end to be like Jesus, as we see Him face to face. Our sermon theme for 2 Thessalonians is facing the end with sobriety. Facing the end with sobriety. Paul speaks about weighty matters. Paul instructs the church on how we are to live our life because we bear this hope of Christ in us. We bear this hope that Jesus is in us. And as we continue in the second letter to the Thessalonians, Paul again wants to give us encouragement on this journey of life to the end. And the end here is about the end of this age when Christians await the beginning of a new age with a new heaven, a new earth that will be ushered in with the second coming of Christ. Pastor Lynette has asked me to preach on the second coming of Christ twice. Maybe she thinks I'm very worldly and wants me to meditate on the end things, the eschatological things. But it's good. It's good to meditate on the things of the end. It gives us true hope that all we see is not all that there is. You know, as I was reading and preparing for this sermon of 2 Thessalonians about the second coming of Christ, I was struck how in the passage we read that in Paul's writing, the number 2 stands out a lot. In the passage that we will read this morning, you will notice, and I will point out to you, that Paul uses 2 reasons for hope, 2 actions, 2 different groups of people, 2 outcomes for these groups of people at the end of the passage, and 2 prayers as he concludes this portion to advance his argument, his exhortation and encouragement that as we wait Jesus' second coming, Jesus Christ will be glorified in us. So I decided it's logical to not have 3 main points, but 2 main points in this sermon following the Paul's structure of 2s. That you should face Jesus' second coming, God's judgment, with peace and purity. Next slide. Peace and purity that Jesus is glorified in you. Peace and purity. Peace and purity. I pray that as we study, as we mull over the passage, that truly God's peace, next slide, God's purity will descend on our church. That we'll be encouraged that as we live in this peace and purity, truly the Lord Jesus Christ will be glorified in us. Our passage this morning speaks about a passage that I preached, but here, that I preached in the second coming, but here Paul cuts straight to the chase. He's already written to the Thessalonian church about the second coming of Christ, and Paul goes on to say that because of the second coming, there are ways and attitudes by which we should live. And I'm reading from 2 Thessalonians 1, verses 5 to 12. All this is evidence that God's judgment is right. So what is this evidence? The evidence is the substance of last week's message that Pastor Lynette preached earlier. Verses 3 and 4, God is working in us, that our faith is growing, that's the substance. Or that's the evidence. Our love for one another is increasing, that's the evidence. That we have faith and persecution in trials. All this is the evidence. So all this is the evidence that one, God's judgment is right. And 2, As a result, you will be counted worthy of the kingdom of God for which you are suffering. God is just. He will, one, what will he do? Pay back trouble to those who trouble you, and two, give relief to you who are troubled, and to us as well. This will happen when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven in blazing fire with his powerful angels, and he will punish, number one, those who do not know God, and two, do obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will be punished with two things: one, everlasting destruction, and two, shut out from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his might. On the day he comes to be, two things: one, glorified in his holy people, us, and be marveled among all those who have believed. This includes you, because you believed our testimony to you. With this in mind, we constantly pray for you that, two things: one, God may make you worthy of his calling, and that two, by his power he may bring to fruition your every desire for goodness and your every deed prompted by faith. We pray this so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Okay, who has ever seen a judge before? I asked a question before. Okay, I have. I'm sure Pastor Lynette has. Who likes to stand before a judge in a courtroom? You know, I don't think many people like to do that, because you associate judges with criminal cases and what you see on TV, and invariably someone gets punished. And you know, in Singapore, the joke is if you try to appeal your sentence, there's a very good chance that your sentence may be increased or even doubled by a court of appeal. But think about it. Who wants to see a judge? The person who wronged another person, or the person who has been wronged? Who wants to see the judge, the wicked or the righteous? The Thessalonian church, who was facing waves and waves of persecution, you know what? They want to see the judge. They want a righteous judge to make everything in their life right, because they have lived righteously, they have lived according to God's ways, and yet they see all these things coming upon them. They want to see the righteous judge. They know there's no way they can face this Roman army, all their persecutors, on their own. And they need, they want, they long for a judge to come and do this for them. The wicked want a wicked judge. The righteous want a righteous judge. The wicked want a dishonest judge. The wicked want a judge they can bribe. The righteous want a wise judge. A judge who sees through all the nonsense, all the smoke and mirrors that the other side is putting up. You know, think about the story of Solomon. You know, the first case that Solomon was ever asked to judge was on who is the rightful mother of a baby. There were two women living in the same house, and they both had babies about the same time. The first woman's baby, unfortunately, died. And in the middle of the night, the woman with the dead baby went to the second woman, and she swapped babies. She placed the dead baby with the second woman and took the second woman's baby. And she barbodo. The second woman woke up in the middle of the night to feed her baby and realized that the baby beside her was dead. And worse still, it was not hers. And she cried blue murder, and both women claimed that the baby that was alive was their own baby. And no one could decide who was the rightful mother of the baby. So both women were brought to King Solomon, the wisest man in the world. And Solomon prayed for wisdom. And he took out a sword and he threatened to cut the live baby in half. The first woman who stole the baby from the second woman said, "That's a great idea, King. You are a righteous and wise judge. Cut the baby in half. I take half, she take half. No one has any babies." You know, the second woman, the real mother of the child, instead said, "Don't kill the boy." Grudgingly, she said, "Let the other woman have him." Well, the true mother of the child would not want her own flesh, her own blood, to be killed. And Solomon, of course, the wise judge, the righteous judge, knew this and awarded the child to the rightful mother, the second woman. You know, the real mother of the child would have prayed for a righteous judge, a wise judge, a judge who can see through all this smoke and mirrors. The wicked first woman, of course, wants a stupid judge who cannot tell right from wrong. She wants a judge who is bribable. Too bad she didn't have any money. If not, she would have bribed him. The righteous look forward to the righteous judge. The righteous look forward to the judge who right all wrongs, who will wipe away all the tears from our eyes. You know, I look at the world and I want the righteous judge to come. I want rescues. There are wars, disasters. We keep on praying for a war to end, but it doesn't seem that it will. Liberalism is threatening to make it hard for us to live out our faith. The refugee situation in the world just gets worse and worse as there's nothing that we can seemingly do. You know, that was what the Thessalonian church, living in this time of persecution, was looking forward to as well. The return of God who judges well, because judgment belongs to the Lord. When will this judgment come? You know, Paul has been consistent in telling the Thessalonian church in both his letters to them and also to all of us when this will happen. When the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven in blazing fire with his powerful angels. This comes at the end of time. Nobody knows when this will happen, but we are guaranteed that this will happen. We are guaranteed that Jesus will come again. Again, Paul does not give any clues to exactly when Jesus will come again because Paul really does not know. So we need not speculate about the different signs and happenings in the world that doomsday preachers harp on and on to predict the end of the world. But Paul does not give an indication of when, but Paul tells us two things: what will happen, and two, how we should live. Well, what will happen when Jesus returns? You know, the Bible does not mince its words. Paul does not mince his words. Jesus did not mince his words. There will be judgment, there will be punishment, and there will be rewards. The punishment, we're told, is of everlasting destruction and being forever shut out from the presence of the Lord. You see, the presence of the Lord is holiness. And unless we are holy, we are covered by the blood of the Lamb, the righteousness of Jesus, we can never enter into God's presence. And at the end of time, when God ushers in a new heaven, a new earth, this is the place where His presence will be always, then those who are holy, those who are clothed in righteousness, will be there. And consequently, those who are not holy, those who are not clothed with the righteousness of Christ, cannot be there. You know, is Jesus unfair? Jesus unfair by doing this? You know, God is love and God is holy. But you know, Jesus is not unfair because this is the story of the Bible from beginning to end. And Jesus has been consistent in telling this story from beginning to end. You know, in the beginning, God made this perfect place, the Garden of Eden, for Adam and Eve to be with Him, to live and work and be in His presence in this garden. But Adam and Eve, they sinned. And because of this, because of their sin, because that they sinned and they were not holy, they had to be banished from the Garden of Eden. Why? Because this is the place where God was. And if God is holiness, He cannot take anything that's unholy around Him. God's holiness cannot tolerate sin. You know, but God didn't just banish them from the garden. God had a plan. God in His love had a plan from the beginning of time to remove Adam and Eve from His presence. But also, the plan was to send Jesus to die on the cross to pay for the sins of the world, you know, including the sins of Adam and Eve. And if you accept this payment for sins, then you can be in the presence of God again. And throughout the Bible, the story of Israel is the same. Just as God gave Adam and Eve a place to live in, a land to live in, God gave Israel land to live in. But Israel repeatedly disobeyed God. And in the end, despite repeated warnings over hundreds of years, Israel continued to sin and God had no choice but to remove Israel from His holy land, His presence. And the Jews went into exile. But still, God in His love continued with His plan to bring His people back into His holy presence through Jesus Christ. And at the end of time, when Christ returns, the punishment for sin is the same punishment for sin since the beginning of the world. And the punishment is to be removed from the presence of God. However, God tells us this time, and Paul tells us this time, God forewarns us that this removal will be everlasting. And this removal will be forever. And we cannot say God is unjust because He's repeatedly warned us time and time again. But the good news is that those who believe in the testimony of Jesus, those who are clothed with the righteousness of Christ, those who believe that Jesus died for the sins of the world and believe that Jesus died for their own sins, they will be saved. And Paul says, not only says saved, they will be glorified. How? They will be glorified by having Christ glorified in them. And at that time, Jesus will be marveled by all believers. All Christians will be marveled and see Jesus. Jesus told a parable about this, the parable of the wedding banquet in Matthew 22. And there's this king, the story goes, there's this king that calls everyone to attend a wedding banquet. And at that wedding banquet, the king saw someone that didn't have wedding clothes. And the king was very surprised, presumably because the king, in the invitation, had given everyone wedding clothes to attend the banquet. You know why? There's no way those people who were invited to the banquet can ever afford to or pay for their own banquet clothes. And this is an analogy of the righteousness of Jesus, which cannot be given, we cannot be earned, but can only be given to us and accepted through the grace of God. And those who come to the banquet in the banquet clothes, clothed in the righteousness of Jesus by believing in Him, those will be ushered into His glory. And those who did not come with the wedding clothes, those who did not come clothed with the righteousness of Christ, cannot come into God's holy presence. In fact, they will be banished from God's holy presence. There's a very interesting promise in 2 Thessalonians. In 1:10, this is a twofold promise. And Jesus said that there are two things that will happen at the end. One, believers will marvel at Jesus, and we will behold His glory, we will experience His love, His joy and peace in its fullness. That's one, we will marvel at Jesus. And two, so we will glorify Him because we will see Him. And two, Jesus will be glorified in His holy people. And Paul says, Jesus will be glorified in His holy people. And Paul says this twice. And so it must be very important. So Paul repeats this again in 2 Thessalonians 1:12 at the end of our passage. He says, we pray this so that the name of our Lord Jesus Christ may be glorified in you and you in Him according to the grace of God and the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, we often think of the second coming of Christ as this marvelous thing where we just open our eyes and we behold the glory of God. But Paul says there is another aspect. We don't just look and behold the glory of God. Jesus Christ will be glorified in us. We will bear a measure of the glory of Christ because we are His holy people. The coming of Christ is not just this event that we will see. It's this event that we are asked to participate in because we will bear the glory of Christ and God, Jesus will be glorified in us. How will Jesus be glorified in us at His second coming? I thought it's just Him descending from the clouds, and we sing this all the time. What do we have to do with the glory of God? What do we have to bring to the table that Paul says that Jesus will be glorified in us? We have something to bring, church. You have something to bring. How we face the prospect of the second coming of Jesus, how we respond to the truth, how we respond to the promise of Christ determines if Jesus is glorified in you. Do you understand? How you respond determines if Jesus is glorified in you. You cannot glorify Jesus on your own. But by believing the truth, by responding to the gospel, by living in hope of the second coming of Christ, then we can glorify God with our life. We glorify God by responding to the grace, by responding to the mercy of God. And how then should we face, how then should we respond to the prospect of Jesus' second coming? From the passage we have read and studied, we should face Jesus' second coming, God's judgment, with two things, peace and purity. Peace and purity, so that Jesus will be glorified in us. Respond to God in peace and purity, and then Jesus will be glorified in your life. If we have perseverance and faith in trials, we will live with peace in our hearts, knowing that our righteous judge indeed at the end of this age, will repay, will indeed right our wrongs, will indeed bring justice. Then we can live in peace, knowing our life is in God's hands. You know, the peace that we live in our life comes from the fact that we need not be our own avenger. We need not be our own avenger. In fact, the street justice we can enact with our own hands pales in comparison to the divine justice that comes from the Father. We can live in this world in peace, even though when we look around, there are many things that are not right. We can live in the world in peace, even if our neighbor is mean to us, insults us, provokes us, incites us to violence. We still can live in peace. We can live in a world in peace, even if we are backstabbed and cheated. And Jesus himself put it in this most extreme way in Matthew 5 on the Sermon on the Mount. You have heard it said, he heard that it was said, eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth. But Jesus says, I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. You know, if we know Jesus is the one that brings justice, then on this personal level, we need not go out and seek vengeance for all the wrong things that have been done to us. We need not keep score of what people did to us, what the things we did not like. We need not harbor anger, we need not harbor resentment in our hearts. And all of this we can give to Jesus. And the author Mitch Albom put it this way. He wrote many books, Tuesdays with Maury, so on and so forth. He's a Catholic writer. And he says this, holding anger is a poison. It eats you from the inside. We think that by hating someone, we hurt them. But hatred is a curved blade. And the harm we do to others, we also do to ourselves. Now, church, right now, do you feel wronged by anyone? Have you been hurt by someone and cannot let go? When someone mentions his name, are the thoughts of this person plagued by your anger and resentment? Do ideas of revenge cross your mind? There was another author, an American Episcopal priest, Robert Farah Capon. He explained anger in this way, and he wrote this book called The Mystery of Christ. And he says, the key to understanding anger is that it always arises out of an offended sense of justice, an offended sense of justice. You can't get truly angry at someone unless you convince yourself he has willfully deprived you of something that was reasonably and rightfully due you. And if we bear in mind that God is our judge, if we cling on to our rights, we insist that we get our rights, then we tend to get angry, isn't it? But if you think about it, is anything really our right? Is anything really ours? Or is what we have really gifts by the grace of God? And we are in a season of Lent. And those of you who come for Ash Wednesday service, now these are the words that we say, that the pastors, that Rufus and I were in the front, as we impose the ashes on you, we say, you know, remember that you are dust, and to dust you shall return. And the truth is that we come to the earth with nothing. All that we have, all that we wear on our body, all that we stay in, the things that we have is given to us by the grace of God. And in the end, if we really return to Christ with nothing except the integrity of our life we live in, should we get angry at all? You know, we will return to Christ with nothing except the integrity of the life you have lived and with the hope that Jesus will be the judge of everything. You know, most of you know that before I answered God's call to be a pastor, I worked as a lawyer. And just last year, I had a chance to wear a lawyer hat again. So last year, my mother-in-law, she had an issue with one of her tenants. And the tenant was a lawyer. It was this small one-man show, and he wasn't paying rent. And he seemed to be using this commercial premises that was rented to him by my mother-in-law for something that was not allowed. And she tried to reason with this tenant, And he kept on giving her this runaround and started writing nasty messages to her. And he said that, oh, you come here, you are interfering with the use of the premises. And he threatened to sue her. And so she approached me for advice. And I was very angry on behalf of my mother-in-law. How can this guy treat my mother-in-law like that? And of course, I immediately took off a pastor's hat and I reverted to being a full-on guns-blazing litigation lawyer. And I went all Ally McBeal on that guy and said, let me see this contract. What he's doing is not right. We have many avenues of recourse. I'll write to him. We can sue. I know a good litigator that can take this on. Cheap and good. We can bring this to a small claims tribunal. So I helped her write this nasty stinker email back to him and started saying, okay, now from this day onwards, day one, we collect evidence, take video, everything. In fact, I helped her engage a lawyer just to take a look. So my mother-in-law, in her wisdom, she went to her church, she goes to another church, and she asked another Christian lawyer to just have a look-see. Now, he is also a friend of mine. He looked at the case, he looked at the facts and says, well, looks like you have a case. But honestly, your rental is nothing to scream about. And the claim is very small. So this type of thing, don't need to get angry. Yes, you may file a case, you may win, but we guarantee you won't get everything or even anything back. So maybe it's better to let him go since you have a month or two left on the tenancy. And no point chasing this small money, being angry, losing sleep at night. And you know, when she told me what this lawyer said, I felt really bad. Here the pastor was telling her, all right, man, let's go. And the lawyer was telling her, oh, turn the other cheek. So we didn't sue in the end, and we forgave him, and all of us slept better at night. Only after that, and said, hey, maybe we should pray for this guy. After the fact, you know. Well, I thank God for a lawyer who can point a pastor back onto the straight and narrow. You know, if we live this life of peace because we have the love, because we have the justice of God living in us, then this is a life worth living, because this is a life that looks for the hope of the second coming of God, looks for the hope of the just God coming to usher in us into a new age. And then truly, we will be glorified and Jesus glorified in us by our testimony. You know, I want to clarify, living a life of peace does not imply pacifism, where we ignore evil, where we ignore injustice. And doesn't mean that, yes, we get slapped on the other cheek, but it doesn't mean that we continue to put ourselves in danger when more harm is being threatened to be done to us. You know, Jesus and Paul were not speaking about systemic injustice, saying all the judges are bad, like, throw out the legal system. But we should. We still need to prosecute lawbreakers. Yes, we can bear arms to defend our country against attacks. Social justice needs to be pursued, where everyone is afforded equal rights and opportunities in life. However, a Christian does not need to feel that there's a need or there's an obligation on his or her part to defend his or her own personal rights or avenge his or her own honor, because God is our judge. We can face Jesus' second coming and God's judgment with peace so that God will be glorified in us. You know, in addition to peace, we also should face Jesus' second coming and God's judgment with purity. Purity so that God will be glorified in us. God is glorified when the saints live pure and worthy lives of His calling. You know, the purity of our life. So because of that, Jesus is glorified in us. The purity of our life in and of itself is not the ultimate good. Your pure life is not the ultimate good. It is good because it reflects the goodness of Jesus Christ given to us by His Word and the Spirit. All the good things you do are not good enough in and of itself. It's only if Jesus is glorified in your life, then those good things become truly good. Well, there are many aspects of purity. And we're always told, church leaders, leadership, church leaders are always told, there are three things that can destroy a man, and of course, three things that can destroy a woman. Money, sex, and power. Money, sex, and power. So we need purity, especially when we deal with these things. We need purity of thought. We need purity of deed when dealing with money, finances. Our business dealings must be honest. We cannot take the 5 cents here, 10 cents there. We need purity when dealing with power. We need humility to treat people well and not take advantage of anybody. Now, if you are in a position of power, you have every opportunity to take advantage of people below you. But purity means that we don't use this position that God has put us in, by the way, to give us an opportunity to take advantage of other people. You know, of the three things, money, sex, and power, I think in our day and age, I just want to focus, I felt led to focus on sex. We live in a hyper-sexualized world. The world has a worldly sexual ethic that is diametrically opposed to the Christian ethic of sex. You know, as a Methodist church, we're also taking this issue very seriously, and track the Trinity Annual Conference recently put together an LGBTQ task force to think further to address our church's response to the issues of same-sex attraction. Church leaders and pastors have been invited to various dialogues among our various churches and what this means for our various churches. And, you know, just yesterday, AMC sent a few representatives to participate in this discussion. And, of course, this comes, I don't think this was planned, but this comes on the back of the Singapore government repealing Section 377A of the Penal Code, which used to criminalize sex between men. It is now no longer illegal to do so. No longer illegal, but in the Christian sexual ethics, it's still immoral. And this comes after a long road of erosion of the Christian sexual ethics. Adultery is not illegal, but it is immoral. Sex before marriage is not illegal, but it is immoral. Abortion is not illegal, but it is immoral. You know, church, we need to speak about and practice a Christian sexual ethics that is pure, that is worthy of God's calling. You know, even before this LGBTQ task force by TRAC, the LCEC, those of you who do know what LCEC is, Lay Church Executive Committee, made up of all the heads of the various ministries that we have and the pastoral team. And at a leaders meeting, one AMC leader rightly pointed out that why do we only talk about the sin of LGBTQ lifestyle? Focus on it. Is it this is the flavor of the month? Well, I think that's a very good question. And as a church, we need to think more broadly about purity of sex. Now, I'm saying this so that as a church, we cannot be accused of not teaching what is a pure Christian sexual ethic. What then is a pure Christian sexual ethic? Well, that marriage is between a man and a woman, one man, one woman, and only in marriage can a man and a woman have sexual relations. And this teaching is consistent throughout the Bible. Well, God instituted it at the start in Genesis when the first family, Adam and Eve, was created. The first marriage, the first family. And Jesus also referred to this. He applied this sexual ethic when he referred to Genesis many times. And this is recorded in the gospel. Now, the gospel of Jesus, the death and the resurrection of Jesus, the hope of Jesus' second coming must give us the peace and encourage us to walk in purity so that Jesus is glorified when he is finally revealed. You know, the Christian sexual ethics then speaks against many of the sins of this age. Fornication, sex before marriage, is explicitly written in the Bible. Adultery or sex outside of marriage, explicitly written about in the Bible. Homosexuality, which directly goes against God's design for marriage and family, explicitly written in the Bible. So we cannot say that we are ignorant. You know, but there are other ways, not explicitly written in the Bible, that puts the purity of the Christian life at risk when it comes to our sexual ethics. It may not be fornication, adultery, or homosexuality. These are directly named and prohibited in the Bible. But there are ways of living, some say the grey area, that taint the purity of our life. These include one, pornography. Pornography is indulging in someone else committing sexual sins. Pornography degrades the worth of people who are created in the image of God. You know, I read that one disturbing trend during COVID is that there was an unprecedented rise in the use of pornography during this time. Unprecedented. You know, like some industries have unprecedented rise. So it's the airline industry, unprecedented fall. Like shipping industry, unprecedented rise. Some companies can give many months, many years bonus in the shipping industry. F&B, unprecedented fall. Pornography, mercurial rise. That's what analysts say. The analysts say, oh, if you are invested in shipping, data center, porn, oh, your stock portfolio will be through the roof. People were feeling lonely. Instead of looking for real relationships, real connections, the internet allowed people to fill the gap in their lives by indulging in this cheap, in this degrading adult entertainment. The Bible doesn't talk about it, but it's against our Christian sexual ethic. You know, another trend on the rise is cohabitation, couples living together before marriage. It is also against the Christian notion of purity. Cohabitation is the doorway to sex before marriage. Cohabitation is not illegal. The penal code does not prohibit it, but it's certainly immoral. It is certainly against the Christian sexual ethics. Cohabitation invades the sanctity, defiles the sacredness of marriage. Now, church, if you're watching porn or you're cohabiting with someone who is not your spouse, I think it's important to reevaluate your life with the warning, with the prospect that Jesus is coming again. And not reevaluate, stop, okay? Don't reevaluate, stop. I mean, it's not actually just Christians, but secular psychologists who warn against cohabiting, who warn against couples staying together before they get married. You know, psychologists and researchers state that couples who cohabit before they get married, on the average, are 30% more likely to divorce than couples who do not. So if you cohabit before marriage, you increase your chances of divorce by 30%. It seems illogical. Simple logic to many young couples say that if we try it out, I think it will make our marriage better. And this has been proven by research to be absolutely wrong. Absolutely wrong. A 2022 Wall Street Journal article said, very interesting headline. Wall Street Journal 2022 says, too risky to wed in your 20s? Not if you avoid cohabiting first. The article recommends that you wait until you are more mature, when you are around. The article says you wait until you are about 30 years old to get married and improves your chances of succeeding in marriage. Why? Because you're more stable in life, you know what you want. However, in the research, there was this interesting finding that women who married very young, in their early 20s, without ever cohabiting, this group of people had the lowest divorce rates in the United States, according to the US government National Survey of Family Growth. So if you marry young and you never cohabited before, you have the lowest divorce rates in America. I believe it should be the same in most developed countries. Let me quote from a very interesting part of this article. And the author writes, About this pattern, the psychologist Galena Rhodes of the University of Denver observes, we generally think that having more experience is better. But what we find for relationships is just the opposite. Having more experience is related to having a less happy marriage later on. One reason, her research suggests, is that previous cohabitations may give husbands and wives experience with breaking up from serious co-residential relationships making them more likely to head for the exit when going gets tough is ingrained in your mind. If the going gets tough, the tough get breaking. So Professor Rhodes, on the next slide, she's in Professor Rhodes' estimation, having a history with other cohabiting partners may also make them compare their spouse critically to previous partners in ways that make them discount their husband or wife. Your husband David may be a responsible and reliable partner, but not as funny as Will, or as good a lover as Nate, two other men you lived with prior to marriage. Keeping such critical comparisons in mind, once you're married, can be corrosive. You know, the article also proffers another explanation. The allure of marriage loses its luster because one can seemingly get all the benefits of a marriage outside a marriage without the responsibility of a marriage. And if and when the cohabiting couple finally gets married, they feel that they've been living together so long, they don't feel any different. And they don't get what the hype of marriage is about. And they get jaded about marriage. You know, the author interviewed a young couple who was Joey and Samantha, who married in their early 20s without cohabiting. And they were interviewed in the article, and they stated that they were just opposite of what of being jaded. They were not jaded. They say, and it says this, "I've been so surprised at the beauty of the mundane," Samantha said, "like cooking together, doing laundry together, decorating for Christmas together, not to mention spending the night together." There are secular reasons for not cohabiting, for keeping to the Christian ethic. But I think the most important reason is that it is the truth of the gospel. No matter how much statistics you quote, the most important thing is that it's the truth of the gospel, the truth presented by the Bible. We can come to God as sinners just as we are. And if we confess our sins to God, He will forgive us. You know, however, you know, God is far too loving to allow us to continue in our current sinful state. God wants to transform us because He knows that there is this life. There is this life of intimacy in Him, and it's far more beautiful, far more amazing than a life that gratifies our flesh, that gratifies our desire, that feeds our anger. You know, we have a God so loving that He died on the cross for our sins. We have a God so powerful that He conquered death and rose from a sealed tomb. We have a God so faithful that He promised He's coming again for us. You know, if you feel that you're not living a life that is peaceful, if you feel you're not living a life that is pure, if you feel that there's a corner of your life that is plagued by anger and vengefulness, if you know that there's a part of your life still living in sin, you know, church, I tell you, it's not too late. You know why it's not too late? It's not too late because Jesus has not come back yet. There is still hope to turn a life around. There is hope in the gospel. There is hope in Jesus. And Paul writes this, Jesus writes this about His second coming to tell you, you know, I've not come yet, and there is still hope. The promise of the second coming is this, that we can live a life of peace, that we can live a life of purity. We can live a life where our Lord Jesus Christ is truly glorified in us. You know, if you feel far away from God, if you feel there's an aspect of your life not totally surrendered to God, if you feel you want to live this life of peace and purity but it's so difficult, you know, the good news is this, God is not done with you yet. You still have a chance when Jesus has not come to give all of your life to Him. And Jesus wants to lead you in this life of intimacy with Him. Not a life that is mired by anger and lust of this world. Now, church, will you right now turn your life, turn your heart to Jesus? We preach on the second coming. I like to preach on the second coming. But the day is not here yet. I don't know when the day is come, but I know for sure something, the day is not here yet. And because the day is not here yet, Jesus is working in you so that you can indeed face Him with peace, so that you can indeed face Him with purity, so that when He comes again, our Lord Jesus Christ truly will be glorified in you. Amen.